If you've just joined in, the market is under a bit of pressure right now. In fact, the advance decline ratio will tell you the true picture. There are over 1,100 stocks on the declining side as we speak, and the mid-cap index, after a 1% fall yesterday, is down about 0.5% or so. So this is definitely, once again, a sell-on rally market. One stock on our radar is CG Power. Second day running, that stock is under pressure. Remember, yesterday, the Risk and Audit Committee raised several red flags about understated liabilities of over 1,000 crores. So we'll discuss what the ramifications of this would be. Anisha is here first up to tell us about the news flow, and then we'll get some guests to analyze this news as well. Anisha.
Well, Sonia, in terms of the Risk and Audit Committee report, they unearthed a lot of transactions that were fraudulently entered in by the employees who were not authorized to do such transactions. In fact, they also talked about how the liabilities were undervalued to the tune of around 1,000 to 1,500 odd crores. And even if you look at the advance to related parties, they were undervalued to the tune of around 2 to 3,000 crore rupees. Remember, the market cap of the company is around 800 crore rupees now. So this is significant in that scheme of things. In fact, if you look at the latest numbers that the company reported as of FY19, which is just the management reported numbers, they have not been verified by the auditors yet. The total liability of the company stands at over 8,000 crore rupees versus an equity of around just 2,000 crores. And there as well, the company says that the net worth of the company was intentionally undervalued because there were a lot of transactions that were written off into the P&L, perhaps with no reason. So there's a lot of reasoning that is needed from the management as to propriety of all of these transactions that were entered. Other than that, they also talk about how some of the employees gave guarantees on behalf of the company and they were not authorized to do so. A lot of pending receivables are there from the land sales that the company did to related parties. So a lot of issues have been brought on by the audit committee. We need to see what the solution is. They are talking about a forensic audit. Let's see what comes out of that.
Okay, thank you very much for just putting the problem on the table, Anisha. We've got Amit Tandon of proxy advisory firm IIAS joining us now. Good morning, Amit. Thank you very much for joining us. Well, this looks like what the board has said. It is yet to be vetted by an auditor. And now the MCA also is going to do its own audit. What are you suspecting, that things are going to be worse than what we already know?
Look, very clearly, we are in a part of a market where the flow of money is kind of stopped between various entities. And once the music stops, then some of the people are going to find themselves without any chair to sit on. This is clearly one such example of what we've seen. My sense at the moment is that, at least just reading what the letter is, that look, they've kind of taken a cursory, or they've taken a first look at what it is. They've kind of tried to piece together what makes sense to them at this stage. But once you start digging in, you are going to find something more. And one of the comments which was made in the letter is that we will do a forensic audit. So this is things which have been unearthed without a forensic audit being put in place. Once you do that, I suspect you will find a little bit more there. Now, how much more is difficult to say, because the size of the problem, my sense is it's already, you know, when you kind of add up the numbers, adds up to about 3,000 crores, which is higher than the net worth. Now, how much more is difficult to say, whether it's another 300 crores or another, 3,000 crores, who knows at this stage.
Amit, the worry is that Avanta has a negligible stake now. Although they are listed as promoters, they've hardly any stake, because Yes Bank, because of the pledged share conversion, has a 12.79% stake. Other major shareholders are HDFC Mutual Fund, Aditya Birla Sun Life, Franklin Templeton and LIC Insurance. Probably some of this is also pledged conversion, I do not know. Who will pick up the pieces and put it together? Does this what become a BIFR case? Does it go to NCLT? How do you resolve when there is no identifiable promoter?
So, Lata, when you kind of look back, just go back about a year or so, around this time last year, we were all talking about what had happened in Fortis. And in a sense, there are a lot of similarities there. The Singh brothers had kind of come down to a minority stake. There were some related party transactions, some of which was recognized, some of which was not recognized. Some of the transactions had been done without the board approval. So in this instance also, we find that there are transactions which have been done without the board approval. There are some transactions which have been recognized. There are other transactions which haven't been recognized. I think one of the differences between that entity and now is that, at least if I'm not mistaken, one of the private equity players does have some stake in it. Therefore, what you have to do is do something which, in a sense, was done in the case of Fortes, which is, one, refresh the board. Second is get the audit firms and the lawyers to kind of go through all the transactions, whatever it is, and give a true and fair picture in terms of what the state of the company is. Now, in case, KKR or one of the other private equity players has some stake, at least they're in a position to bring in a management team, ensure that, look, the company's put back into the path of profitability. You need to remember that as a brand, it's been fairly strong. It's got a relatively small balance sheet, but relative to that, the turnover is fairly high. And, if you go back 20, 25, 30 years, it's a fairly strong and well-respected engineering company.
Yeah.
I'm just presuming that the people skills or the manufacturing side are there, and therefore there is value to be had. What you need to do is whoever is now going to come over and take over responsibility, be it the private equity player or they bring in a joint venture partner at this stage, they're going to be able to, do a one-time cleanup and get the company back on a profitable path. But look, we saw in the case of Fortis, what has happened is it's, kind of a year and a half, and their management is kind of still struggling to put the various pieces together. So this is also, it's not, there's going to be pain, at least in the short to medium term. After that, assuming that there is a good management team in place, you can hope that there is some kind of path to salvation. Otherwise, like a number of other companies that have kind of gone under, this too will risk sinking.
Sure. Amit, hi, good morning. This is Sonia here. So, of course, all of that is secondary management changes, etc. But the big question now is, how significant a role does the auditor play in all of this? You know, in these frauds becoming so huge and allowing such lapses, because, the Risk and Audit Committee has raised red flags now. But what were they doing up until now? I mean, these are companies that have statutory internal auditors. They have committees. They have boards, who sign off on all these balance sheets. So do you think that the auditors itself are to blame for such lapses?
Look, it's quite interesting if you go back to the history of the audit firm. So in 2016, if I'm not mistaken, they appointed Chaturvedi and Shah, who kind of resigned within a year. Then in 2017, a local firm was appointed. And clearly, things must have been a little bit amiss, because in 2018, they brought in a joint auditor, which was an SRBC firm, ENY's, a firm affiliated with the ENY group. And what the disclosures through the stock exchange have said is that this was the firm which kind of worked with them to, reconcile some of the accounts and figure out what's going on. So clearly the fact that you had auditors moving was that none of them were comfortable with what was going on, but clearly none of them kind of raised a red flag early enough till the last change which has happened. So I'm not going to jump to conclusions at this stage, but clearly, as you point out, the role of the auditors over the last few years needs to be looked at a little bit more closely. It needs to be scrutinized in terms of what did they do, when did they find out that the numbers weren't really adding up, when did they find out that some of the numbers were not appearing in the balance sheet. Because if 1,000 crores, if banks have lent the money, it couldn't have just disappeared. It can't be that banks were giving them suitcases of cash to say that, okay, here's the next loan you have to take. It would have come in through a bank account. What happened there? Was the bank account even reported to the, was management and the board aware of this? Or was it just kind of you'd created a account on the side, and some of the transactions were being done through that. So it's kind of a pretty messy situation, if you ask me.
So what are the next thing to watch out for? The MCA report, is it?
Look, the MCA will come out, but I think what we need to watch out is in terms of, you know, if there's a forensic, whether it's the forensic and the MCA. Just first is, at least we need to figure out the size of the hole. The other is that, look, at the end of the day, these companies lose value very quickly. You know, so if employees are not paid, factory has to shut down, then there's absolutely no value in the company. So you need to figure out whether there is value in the assets, and that needs which is the best way of keeping the enterprise going. If you shut it down, you really get nothing. We've seen what's happened in the case of Jet Airways, when you had a entity as a going concern realizes a completely different value than if it's allowed to fail.
That's okay.
So do you think SEBI needs to sit up and take action? I mean, anything that you would expect from the regulator?
Look, I think at this stage, everyone is going to kind of come in and look at what's going on. When at this stage, whether it will be the responsibility of the MCA, but SEBI will also want to look at the role of the board, look at the role of the committees, what has happened, understand what the sequence of events has been.
But
I would say that, you know, in all these things, speed is of the essence. So if you are able to get things sorted out over the next 2-4 months, there's a hope of salvaging something out of the entity. The more you let it drag on, the more difficult it is going to be. So I would say whoever it is there now, whether you need now to bring in a new CEO who kind of brings it as a holding on operation, or whether, you know, I think Sudhir Mathur had just come in and he was kind of independent director, and then he came in and signed the accounts, taking, you know, the onus of the full investigation which is going on, whether it is him or whoever it is. At this moment, unfortunately, there's not enough information in the public domain, but we need to, whoever are the big boys in the room, and maybe it's the private equity investors and the and also the mutual funds, they need to kind of sit down. I'm not saying they need to take a view in terms of how they see the roadmap over the next, 1 month, 3 months and 6 months.
Yep.
Looking beyond that is, at this moment, a little bit ambitious.
Okay. Thank you very much, Amit. We'll perhaps be asking for your comments oftener, going by the nature of things. It's just that there is no identifiable person who will take charge. One hopes somebody in the board does that. Well,